Hey, what's up, Big Earl? Northtown Sound, how's it going? This is yet another episode of Old Mod Cons. This is a feature on this channel where I'm doing work on guitars, which doesn't involve, you know, stringing and wiring and stuff, but where we're getting a little bit more involved on things. So we can call these, hey, let's watch the fat man fuck up another guitar. Today, we don't have a victim, though. We have a patient. And I've actually owned this guitar for maybe, an hour and a half now. I find in the fall, I get into this thing where I feel like working on instruments. And there's a bass that's over there that's on in shot that I'm going to be working on. I got to swap a neck on it. I'm not going to do a video. It's not going to be that interesting. I'm looking for a new set of flat wounds for it. And man, flat wounds are expensive in Canada right now. So hunting around, I went over to my friends over at the acoustic music shop here in beautiful Edmonton, Canada. They couldn't help me out, but they did help me out with this. This is a score. Boys and girls, are you ready? This is a Godin LGHB. I picked up for $299. You know what I love about this part of Canada? People spend less time checking out the quality of instruments and more time reading the damn things. If you've never played Godins, Godins are the guitars and the basses that North American manufacturers should be making. Really nice guitar, and I've actually been looking for one of these for quite a while. And outside of being filthy, it's in quite good nick, except for a really weird issue, which is why I think I got this so cheap. If we go to the back, we'll take a look at that neck. What this feels like is that somebody had tried to wax the neck off, sort of the way Music Man's are done, and there's some weird dingage on here. Now that one looks a lot worse than it actually is. There's some stuff on the edge that feels as bad as it looks, but this actually feels worse than it is. That's quite a ding. So I'm gonna have to try to strip that off, and then I'm gonna have to steam these out. I understand what they were trying to do with this, but right now it just feels, some places are super gummy feeling, and it really needs some love. So that's gonna be the dealio. I gotta see if I can take whatever this is off of this neck. Grab yourself a snack. Let's see if I can save this thing. It's very shiny here. Not so much on the back of the peg head in the wood. And the heel, this has definitely been off more than once. It's clear. So there's definitely a coat of something on here. Maybe right there if we can catch a reflection. Okay, so I've been reading up. Everybody's either saying naphtha or acetone. And of course, I don't have any lighter fluid. I didn't put the lid on right. That's bad. So I'm going to start with some isopropyl, see what happens. That was interesting. Don't know if you can see the shine. Nothing appears to be coming off, but it's gotten a hell of a lot shinier. That's interesting. And some of the places where it was goopy is kind of, it's really bad in here. This isn't anywhere near as bad. You know, for shits and giggles, I'm going to try a little bit of acetone on this. And don't spend money on acetones. Nail polish is acetone. That's all it is. Tell your girlfriend that. Right there. Acetone. See? And I shouldn't have probably said girlfriend. Just tell whoever you know who has nail polish. They're putting acetone on their nails. I'm one of these guys. I've never understood the point of makeup and stuff, so just doesn't look good on me. This is weird. I'm starting to think it might not be wax. Can't see anything on the cloths. This has gotten duller, and you can definitely feel like it's coming off. Furniture polish? I don't know what the hell they use on this thing. Well, the acetone's working, so I'm going to keep going with that. I put a big glob of acetone on the peg head. It's not affecting anything. But this doesn't feel the same. This feels like wood now. Between the wet sanding, the acetone, and some barkeeper's friend, I think I've gotten it all off. The neck isn't as shiny as what it was. And one thing I noticed, because I got to touch that little bit of sanding up, but the camera gets this. Yeah, I can even see it here. See that dividing line? There's one there. There's one down here. And it's sticky where that stuff is. So somebody definitely put a coat of something on this neck after the fact. Okay, so we're back in the arsenal room. Looks like it's gonna rain, but there's something we gotta do inside anyways. We're gonna go after these divots that are in the neck. These places where it's low. How do you get rid of that? Well, steam. That's how you do it. And what's the easiest way of doing it? Well, you need some damp paper towel and a soldering iron. That's basically all you need. It always sounds like grilling steak to me. It just sounds so wonderful. I'm talking a lot about food, aren't I, lately? Yeesh. Okay, so you saw the steam rising up there, and it's brought that up some. You don't want your paper towel soaking wet. Just damp. If it's soaking wet, you don't actually create that much steam. This is what you want. You see that? But it's now raised up pretty well to the surface. Now, what I'm going to have to do, I have a bunch more to do, obviously, but I'm going to have to let that dry and cool overnight, because it may sink down again, and then I'll have to do this again tomorrow. It does take a couple of tries sometimes, but that's the way it goes. I'm going to attack this big divot here, because this is the one that's actually bugging me the most. That's some serious gouging that's in there. If I take a card, I might be able to show you. It fits in there, just tries to go in there. So now I'm gonna have to steam the crap out of these, so let's try it.
I had a brilliant concept while I was working today. I was like, you know, if I take all the finish off, maybe that's gonna help me with steaming this, and yeah, amazing how well that worked. So, this top dot now, you can't feel. This stuff here is completely gone. And these two nasty divots here, focus in. This top one feels like a tiny, tiny little crack. And the bottom one feels like a little bit more of a crack. Not much though. I'm going to steam this just a little bit more, but I'm going to try to do something first, which has always been a fail to me. I'm going to try to get rid of these stain marks. Mahogany, hydrogen peroxide. Some people will suggest, trying to get this so there's not a lot of shadow. Some people will suggest an acid, but bases work a lot better on mahogany, I find. So I'm just dabbing some on, give it a scrub, and continue doing this with the other ones. Basically what you're doing is the alkalinity more or less kind of bleaches the wood a bit. This side here you're not going to notice that much because we're trying to get on these and these are like really heavy duty. Maple necks, I've used just bleach and it works fantastically. But yeah, that's probably going to be too much on this thing. I'm not really holding my breath on this doing much, but if I can back those off a bit. So I started fading with hydrogen peroxide, but then I remembered this summer I was reading on a website
We're talking about removing like burn marks when people are cutting like pine and stuff like that. And they suggested witch hazel, which kind of makes sense. It's an astringent. So this is a combination of witch hazel, there it is, and hydrogen peroxide. I think this did more, so I'm going to try this by itself next time I have to do this. And for those of you who don't know, witch hazel is actually, it's a sunburn treatment. So when you're sunburned, you put this on, it really helps. I am a pale pink prairie boy. I go through a lot of this stuff. I've got, these guys have gone from being deep dings to feeling like just little scuff marks, which is awesome. That one you can't feel, the one up top you can't feel. So I'm happy. I'm going to strip this down, oil it off, and finish it. I ended up having to go to 2000 grit. I thought I had some 1200, but I didn't. See that shine? That's just wood. And just did a quick fretboard, didn't need much, so just cleaning a couple of cooties off of here and dressing it. So now we're going to oil both sides. Again, in the oil debate, I live in a place where the furnace is on 4 months out of the year. It helps around here. Maybe not in your location. Now you see, I knew this was going to happen. You throw some oil on, those marks come right back. Well, they're a little softer now, so they sure feel a lot better. It's a shockingly good match. That was just our friend Mr. Lemon Oil. So I'm just going to let this sit and cure up. Let's take a look at the body, shall we? There's kind of a difference between pocket markings and pocket graffiti. And what the heck was going on there? That's really freaking bizarre. Somebody was playing with nails? I don't know. That nail almost looks like it's going through that date stamp, so maybe that was done afterwards. I don't know. There's nothing on this side, so we're fine there. Tight, tight pocket. Tight on this. Very tight. These pickups are filthy. So I'm going to have to clean these off because these are gross. I got to see what kind of pickups these are. They sound quite good. Some of these were Duncan's. Some of these were just Godin pickups. I don't know which these are, so we're going to try it out. I'm going to show you a big, big, big tip though. You see how those pickups are sitting? How low they are? Even with the neck on, they're very, very low. That's one of two signs. Either number one, buddy wanted more clearance finger picking, or number two, somebody set up this guitar who knew a thing or two about setting up guitars. Hot pickups, you sink back. Trust me, try it sometime. But I gotta clean these off. No markings. So I'm gonna assume these are Godin's. Sound really good though. I quite like the way they sound. Kind of sloppy potting on these. But I'm gonna have to scrub that. Ew, it's all dirty. Officially perplexed. I have no clue what happened here. I have tried everything. I've tried cleaner, I've tried the lighter fluid, I even went in, did the toothpaste trick. Before anyone laughs, toothpaste is a great metal polish. Check it out. Read up about stuff. So I think unless I can get like a coarse grind polish and just basically like grind that right off, that's gonna be there. That's really weird. Okay, strung up, just stretching the strings. Quick point, a lot of people miss. We head up to the peg head. A lot of people understand that you should be stretching these as well, especially the Efemahui people. For your Giamahui people though, here's a good one. Stretch down here. I know that seems like overkill, but man, overkill is a good thing.
It's now a couple of weeks after I finished the last little bit of setting this up. I took this to the Edmonton Guitar Show. Really sorry I didn't get any video done there, but I was busy. Man, I was like selling right, left, and center. It was awesome. Thank you to everybody who came out who's watching this. Met a couple of people who actually watch these videos. I'm amazed people actually watch these videos. It still blows my mind. Everybody had lots of nice things to say about Gorham. They sure like that neck. The folks from the acoustic music shop came over and said, wow, you did a good job on that thing. You can still see everything on it, which is not a big surprise, but she feels sexy there. Trying to figure out how to name this thing. You know, two hum, single cutaway. So I was thinking, well, Jonesy, Wada, Dreaming was in there for a little bit. But it's really strange. Every time that I play this thing, I'm playing riffs that are reminiscent of like classic hard rock, blues rock. I don't know where that's coming from. I believe you let the instrument decide how it wants to be played. That's a whole other video in there. And that's what this thing seems to like for some reason. I don't know. So this is Gorham, named after the guy who should be the next president of the United States of America. And that's right, old man punk noise monkey name-checking 70s hard rock. Okay, that's the way it goes. So, as usual, we are running dirt clean, go clean or go home. And I quite like the sound of this thing clean. Sounds really, really nice and open to me, which I quite like, that sort of 60s hum sound. I mentioned in the previous video hot pickups and the lowered back. So somebody knew how to set up the pickups on these things. I adjusted them a little bit, not very much though. And so it's not glaringly bright, which is what I like. Quite like that actually. We go over to the neck pickup. The neck pickup is quite heavily recessed. Hopefully you can see it on that angle, which just gives it that weird openness that I really like on neck humbuckers. Quite like that. And then in between, took a little bit to balance it, but I got it in what I refer to as the sweet hitchhiker mode. You'll know what I mean. Quite like it. This thing does have coil split capabilities that I really don't care about. Bridge on single coil. Yeah, whatever. And then neck on single coil, which I know this is heresy, the worst sound in the world to me, the sound of like an Essimahui on the neck pickup. Into it. So I'm really just going to be doing the hummies on this thing all the time. So naturally, hard rock is not that clean. Need a little bit of grit in there. So I grabbed the Eno Treble Overdrive. Just because if I throw this into balls on distortion mode, you're just going to get a bunch of pistols covers, which most of you don't care about. And again, for shits and giggles, I've got the Eno Ambient Echo on here as a thickener slash slapback on things, just to give it a little bit of jiggle. And hummies, gain, what more can you say? Seriously, I never go. That's what I'm saying. Like, classic rock to me is that. Why do I like the LG Potty so much? It's kind of the perfect amalgamation between Fullerton thinking and Kalamazoo thinking in my books. So you have that extended front upper bout, which obviously puts the strap button kind of between where an S Mahui and a J Mahui would be. So they balance amazingly well, which I like. Like the dance, that was fun. Single cutaway though, so you get a bit more of a ring even unplugged. Because you got the tunematic, this thing's gonna ring in ways that the Fullerton stuff could never do. It never quacks, which I quite like. I hate that twang sometimes. But the weird thing about this, and I don't know if I pointed this out before, so I'm going to point it out now. The body is very slightly asymmetrical. So if you go from the midpoint on the strings up here, midpoint of the strings down to there, it's thicker here. So when you're sitting down, it's up a bit. It's sort of like the old Howard Roberts models, but in a solid body form. Brilliant design, and my gut hangs in the perfect place, which is just awesome. So if I'm sick and tired of playing, I just wanna play some gut drums, hey, I can, it's cool. And the neck, oh, this neck feels just so good right now. I need some private time with this neck. So that's that one. That's Gorham. I'm so happy I got this thing. I'm so happy. This is a fucking rocking guitar, let me tell ya. And you notice from that video, I'm not just a guy who hacks the snot out of guitars. I know how to fix them. I know how to repair them. It's just more fun to mutilate them, frankly. And this thing, that neck, turned out really nice. I'm never going to get rid of those spots. And because of how the grain is crushed here, that's always going to be there. But I mean, it just feels like a little dimple now. It's not the divot it was. The only mod that I've done to this so far is the strap buttons. The original are like strap lock style. These are just big strap buttons I had kicking around because I don't run strap locks. There's better ways of dealing with that. The only issue I have with this thing is the electronics. I hate blade switches and I don't need the coil split on this thing. So that's going to end up being a toggle at some point. I got to figure out how to do that. And the pots have really been played. Whoever had this thing knew how to play a guitar, which is weird because most of the electrics I buy secondhand are from players where, you know, the pots are seized because nobody will ever move them. Pickups jacked right up against the strings. This was set up by somebody who knew how to run high output humbuckers and somebody who rode the volume and tone, which is what I do all the time. The tone pot especially though, when it's under load, when you play a note, it's very noisy. And I have run some contact cleaner on it. I think it's just worn. This thing was loved. I don't know why they got rid of it, but I'm the new love now. So, and again, this neck, you cannot believe how nice it feels. So I'm really happy with this one. So that's Gorham. Great guitar. Not mean to sound too Canadian, but Godin, eh? The good guys ain't no hosers, huh? They got their damn good axes there. So, that's my fifth Godin.
Okay, four LG bodies. Okay, Godin, bring back the LG body, please. Wicked. They still make great guitars. Check them out. And not a lot of dinero for what you're getting compared to what the other boys are gouging you on. So, speaking of Econo, you dug the sound of those Eno pedals there, head on over to my website, northtownsound.com, or if you prefer, reverb.com/shop/northtownsound. I've got those Eno pedals there. I got a bunch of really cool pedals there that don't cost a lot of money. I'm working on a couple of things. Fingers crossed I can pull this off. It's all down to the exchange rate. Hopefully we can do it. And you know what? If you dug this video, tell your friends. If you learned something from this video, tell your friends. If you didn't like this video, why'd you watch it? Big Earl here at Northtown Sound. Thanks a lot for watching, okay? Later.